Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and let me welcome you to today's economics seminar, which focuses on the topic of digitization and the quality and quantity of new music, books, and movies. We are most fortunate to have Professor Joel Waldfogel with us, who is one of the leading researchers in the field of copyright economics. In fact, this is quite an interesting field where I would say digitization itself has been important in spurring research studies. What is interesting that, you know, some maybe 15 years ago, studies started to emerge, and I think the first wave of studies looked at the effects of file sharing on revenues and how the music industry is affected. And I think, you know, the latest wave of studies that maybe started some 5-7 years ago, and Professor Waldfogel can describe that much better than I can, has gone much beyond that, and it has looked at, you know, how creativity as such is affected by digitization. Today's seminar will not present a single paper. Instead, Professor Waldfogel will present a synthesis of some of his latest research work that focuses precisely on the types of creative outputs that you see in the title of the seminar. I don't want to say too much about that work in advance. We'll leave this to Professor Waldfogel. Just one or two words about his biographical background. He's a professor at the University of Minnesota. For a long time, he used to be a professor at the University of Pennsylvania in the United States. He's also a research associate at the National Bureau of Economic Research. And he has recently done a lot of work also in Europe, working with the Joint Research Center of the European Commission, where he has been able to get access to a lot of interesting data, I think especially on the music industry, from which his research benefits. And so, you know, he is in Europe quite often, and the fact that I think he was in Zurich was quite advantageous. We took advantage of this opportunity and invited him to Geneva to present today's seminar. So I suggest, as usual, we have about 40, 45 minutes of presentation. Please feel free to ask any clarifying questions, but maybe if we can leave the big substantial existential questions till the end. So Professor Waldfogel.
Thank you for the very kind introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here. It's unusual for me to be sitting down. I'm tethered to this microphone, so you have to imagine me animated and excited, but I'm sitting down. All right, so as Carsten said, I'm talking about a series of papers, and so you might find that I'm not going into as much depth as you hope, so we can, if you want to go into more depth on any particular thing, we can certainly talk about it at the end in the discussion time. All right, though, the general topic, though, is, as the title suggests, it's about digitization and its impacts on the quantity and quality of new products in these sectors. It's music, books, movies, others as well. I'll talk a little bit about a few other copyright-protected sectors. When we think about digitization and media industries, really it's a two-part story. It started with bad news on the demand side. And really the first affected industry was music. It was affected by Napster. And Napster came along, and Napster and then subsequent technologies for consuming without payment, they were bad news that reduced the ability for firms to generate revenue from any particular products that they might have created. But that's just part of what happened. You know, and that's what, you know, as Carsten said, that's what researchers were focused on for quite some time, myself included. I'll be a little critical of that research because I participated in it, so I have a right to criticize it. But, you know, eventually I think we've noticed that something else happened in addition, which is that there's cost reduction on the supply side. You know, big reductions in the cost of production, promotion, distribution. And so these things together, if you think about it, you know, would have different effects on what would happen in these industries than if, say, only bad news on the demand side had happened. Now, those two elements, the demand, sort of the negative shock to demand and the negative shock to supply, or negative shock to costs, rather, along with something else that's very important about media products, which are typically the copyright-protected sorts of products, which is that it's very difficult to predict which products are going to be commercially appealing and successful and economically important at the time of investment. So William Goldman, the screenwriter, has this very famous quote, "Nobody knows anything." I think "nobody knows anything" is a good description of the predictability of success in these industries. And so these various effects together, I think, have produced revolutionary effects on recorded music, books, movies, television, There are lots of new products, many of which are economically consequential. And so what I'd like to do today, in addition to talking about findings about a variety of industries from a variety of papers, is also to highlight some rather non-traditional sources of data that I think I've had to resort to, in part because I've decided, you know, once one accepts the notion that the right question is documenting the quality and the service flow of the new stream of products, then one has to become a bit Catholic about what sorts of data to look at. Anyway, so I'll get to all of that. So I want to emphasize this again, because I think this is a bit of a changed research priority relative to much of what's happened. You know, piracy remains an interesting and important question for many firms and, you know, actors in these industries. But really, when you think about the goal of intellectual property protection, and I certainly don't have to lecture you about that, I think the question that, you know, that public policy means to address is the supply of new products robust, and the quality of those products and the service flow? And the question, I guess, is which evidence speaks to whether copyright is properly or adequately fulfilling its function? So, you know, we could ask, you know, in the vein of my additional goals, you know, you could ask the question, are we experiencing a crisis? And certainly there are some data that that says that we are, some data that say that we are, but there are others that really say very different stories. And, you know, the last little kind of subtext is that better data are needed and more data infrastructure so that it's possible to do things like what I've started to do, but in systematic ways. There's a lot of some data don't exist, other data are expensive, so it's rather hard to document what's going on. Okay, but to get to the substance of it, I'm going to start by talking about Napster and music, sorry, music rather, and I'll talk about the quality of music since Napster, rising or falling. I'll just go ahead and hint now that I'm going to claim that it's been rising, and then we need to talk about why. How on earth could that be in an environment in which there's been a collapse of revenue to recorded music? So I'll talk about a theoretical explanation of why that might be so and think about its implications. What does it imply that we should see if that were true and look at those questions both for music and other industries, okay? And it's sort of, in some ways, I guess I'm telling you the story in the order in which it came to me, but I think it's a relatively coherent order. All right, so every discussion of digitization, especially in music, starts with a picture of the bad news. And so one of the kind of bad news pictures is the picture of the evolution of the recorded music revenue. So this happens to be a picture of U.S. recorded music revenue, although pictures for Europe look very, very similar. It rises and had risen for quite some time, occasional fluctuations due to, you know, ups and downs of the economy, but then it has fallen consistently and sharply since 1999. Even if you add digital back in, it's fallen. Overall, it's fallen by something like 60% in the U.S. and Europe. So that's big bad news. It really does look like the sky is falling. well, there we go. That's a way to think about it. I don't know if that's fair use. I hope that's fair use. Okay, but the research response to this event, the Napster event, was what I would characterize as a kerfuffle, which is a funny word, but a kerfuffle about whether file sharing cannibalizes sales. Now, in some ways, that's a seemingly not stupid question, but seemingly sort of trivial question in the sense that the question is whether the ability of consumers to obtain products without paying for them would reduce the ability of sellers to generate revenue from trying to sell them. Some people didn't need research to know the answer, but, you know, academics play by Marquis of Queensberry rules, and so we do need evidence. And actually, to be fair, it's fairly hard to garner evidence about this because of the problem that popular things are popular when and where they're popular. So that means you'll see high volumes of unauthorized or unpaid activity at the same time you see high volumes of paid activity simply because those popular things are popular at the same time. Moreover, you'll see people who do a lot of one doing a lot of the other. Doesn't mean that doing the one, that is stealing, may I use the word stealing? Anyway, some people object to it, that causes people to buy more. Anyways, I'd say that the dust has settled in that literature, and most people believe that that indeed that unpaid consumption reduces the ability of sellers to generate revenue. And so, in fact, a big chunk, if not all, of the reduction in revenue in recorded music is attributable to piracy or file sharing. Now, that, you know, I felt like, and I think the literature, participants in the literature felt like it was an accomplishment to answer that question, even though in some sense industry participants didn't need that question answered, didn't think they needed it answered. But about 5-6 years ago, I had a little bit of an epiphany. There's the road to Damascus. And it occurred to me that that revenue reduction, although again very important, especially for industry participants and incumbent participants, is not really the question relevant, or not the only question relevant to thinking about whether copyright is working. We should be worrying about the flow of new products, okay? Because I shouldn't have to remind myself this, but I'm putting it parenthetically there. We should worry about consumers as well as producers, okay? Now, the perspective of industry in the music context does have in it a notion of concern for consumers. I mean, both the Recording Industry Association of America and the IFPI do talk about how these are investment-intensive products. And so if there were a collapse of revenue, there could be an end to investment, and therefore, not their words, these are my words, but an audio stone age, a reduction in production of new things. So that's not a crazy concern in the context of a 70% reduction in revenue. But as I mentioned at the outset, file sharing is not the only innovation. Really, if you think we're living through a digitization experiment, it's a compound experiment that includes both, as I said before, bad news on the demand side, but good news on the cost side, at least potentially. I haven't shown you any evidence of that yet, but let me claim at least that it's possible that that's happened, that the costs of production and promotion and distribution have fallen, in which case one wouldn't need as much IP protection, whatever that means, to generate the same level of output as before. Okay? But that's just an hypothesis or, you know, a contingent guess. Really, the question that addresses whether any of this is so is what the question, you know, what has happened to the, quote, quality of new products, in the case of music, since Napster. Now, I put quality in these distancing quotes because usually, once I say the word quality in the context of a product that has aesthetic connotations, I start a fight that I don't mean to fight. I don't want to start and I can't finish because I'm an economist. So for me, quality doesn't mean anything aesthetic. As a human it does, but as an economist it does not. It merely means whatever it is that causes people to go out and buy stuff, okay, or consume it. Whatever it is that shifts the demand curve around is an economist's notion of quality, okay? And I don't mean to sound vulgar, but that is, I am an economist, so I have no choice. All right. If one accepts that this question, assessing the quality or service flow, maybe that's a less contentious word, but if one accepts that the question of assessing the service flow from new creative products is the right question, then one has to go after it, even though I think at the outset you have to say it's a hard question. It's a very hard question. So let me admit it's a hard question, but if you agree it's worth answering, then I'll continue. So in the music context and more broadly, I can think of two ways to go about studying this. One is critics' best of lists, by which I mean things like the best of all time or best of the last 10 years, those kinds of lists, not the best of this year, since of course there are always 10 best every year, so a time series of the number of 10 best every year wouldn't be very informative. But if you have longer term lists, then you can learn something about the volume of work that critics believe surpasses some threshold, some constant threshold of quality over time. So that's a kind of an unusual, even weird approach for an economist to take. But then in addition to that, I have a more conventional approach that I like to take when I have the data, which is usage-based. And so I'm going to talk about these two different approaches to documenting quality over time or service flow over time, one based on critics and one based on usage information by time, that is by calendar time, as well as by vintage of the production of the product. And I'll get to more about that as we go. So when we think about the critic sort of information, the underlying data are of the following sort. There's a famous, Rolling Stone volume, the 500 best albums of all time. That book came out in 2004. If you take the 500 albums in that volume and you bin them into the years in which they were originally released, then you get an idea of one of these sort of indices of the volume of high quality music produced over time. And you see that the folks at the Rolling Stone think that 1970 was the zenith, and it's mostly been bad news since then. Now, the Rolling Stone index isn't really that useful for digitization, because although one could mark the beginning of digitization at a number of different years. Certainly 1999 is an important year, and years since then are important, and that index ends around 04. So I would need more than just this source of data to construct indices. But this is an example, and a famous example of a data source like this. Now, I spent a summer a few years back, more than a few now, finding a lot of critic lists like the Rolling Stone list. And what this graph shows you, you can't read it, so it's just a graph that's meant to suggest how much work I did. But vertically, you can see different indices or different sources of data. So Pitchfork is in there and a whole bunch of different sources. And across the horizontal axis, you see the time coverage. So the point is I have indices covering, or I can construct indices covering the entire period since the beginning of time, which for me is 1960. Okay. Yes, I love coming to Europe and talking about the beginning of time in music as 1960. All right, anyways, if I make an index out of each of these data sources and then statistically splice them together, so sort of in geek terms, all I'm doing is if YIT is the number of works from index I that were originally produced in year T, I take the natural log of that and regress it on an index dummy, the index fixed effect, and then a common set of time dummies. So what I'm doing when I plot the thetas is I'm producing a spliced index of quality according to these critics. Here's what it looks like. Now I've put a little modesty panel on the years since 1999 just to maintain excitement. Remember what's going on here is that the revenue to recorded music is falling by 70% in the 10 years following what's covered. And so what happens to the index of quality, high quality stuff as perceived by critics? Well, it goes flat. It doesn't fall, it goes flat. Now, if you were kind of a hair splitter, you might say that it had been falling and is no longer falling, and so relative to falling, it's rising. That's a little bit too cute, I think, an argument. But certainly, relative to the plummeting nature of recorded music revenue, flat is an interesting contradiction. Okay, so there we are, index of vintage quality. Now, let me talk about an entirely independent approach. I mentioned there were two, one based on critics, another based on usage data. So let me talk about the usage data. This is a bit more conventional because instead of relying on the views of elites, this is about actual economic decision making, you know, behavior, what people choose to buy or listen to. Anyway, so let me talk about how I do this. So suppose one were to have data on some usage measure, either consumption, so sales, let's say, or airplay, something like that, by both calendar year and year of original release, okay? The idea is this. If one vintage's music is better than another's, then its greater appeal should generate greater consumption or airplay after accounting for its age. All right, so we know, we should expect, and I'll show you in data that it's true as well, at any point in time, older stuff is used less than newer stuff. That is to say that music depreciates. But after accounting for the depreciation pattern, if we have some, you know, more, multiple years of data, we can actually look and see the vintage impact on usage and try to infer something about the quality, and again, quality just in the sense of service flow or usage of the different vintages. Okay, so what do I have? Now, there are good, very good data out there. At the time I started this research, I didn't have that much money. So, but what I could get my hands on 5 years of airplay data aggregated. So it's U.S. airplay data based on millions of spins on the radio. But all I have is the share of the spins on the radio from each year that are for music from each previous year. Right. So it's kind of a lot of data, but it fits in a spreadsheet. I wished I had at the time like Nielsen data on the sales of individual songs or albums, but instead I couldn't afford that. What I did have though is the Recording Industry Association of America's gold and platinum certifications. So what that is, when an album hits 500,000 in sales, it's certified gold in the US. When it hits 1 million, it's certified platinum. When it hits 2 million, double platinum, and so forth. Now, there are something like 20,000 certifications in the data between 1960 and 2010. It's a tiny fraction of music released, but it's the bulk of total music sales. So it's not a crazy place to go looking. And by the way, since one knows when things were released, one can use those data to create shares of sales in a calendar year that are from each previous vintage. Anyways. So what I do, and again, this is another kind of geeky slide, but what I do is I define STV as the share of the music used in year T that was originally released at vintage V, right? So in year T, if you sum across the Vs, it would be 1. And so for a given year T, the S is going to vary across vintages because of depreciation. That's sort of the noise here, but then also because of differences in usefulness or quality. That's what we care about. So to get at this, I just regressed the natural log of STV on age dummies, so, and that's going to flexibly account for depreciation, and then vintage dummies, which is going to flexibly allow me to reconstruct an index of, again, quality and distance in quotes. So yes, the vintage dummies are the index of vintage quality. So what do I get? This is the AirPlay. This is what I get from the AirPlay data. Now, what's interesting about this, notice how it has a peak around 1970, just like the critic stuff, even though it's entirely independent. It's not the same data set or something. It's entirely independent. So we see that, according to AirPlay, that conditional on age, the stuff from about 1970 is used a lot relative to other vintages. And then it falls. Then we get to 1999. And again, I've tried to build some excitement there with a blind, but any guesses what happens? Well, I can't stand the suspense. It rises rather substantially after 1999. Which again, what that means in words is that given how old the music from the period since 1999 is, it gets used more than music that age typically had gotten used. That's what that means. That's what my quality index means. Now, what about, yes.
Can I maybe ask one clarifying question? To what extent do you account for demographic shifts there? In a sense that I think, you know, you have this baby boomer generation that got older and older. I wonder if they boomed in the 1970s and to what, you know, that is that something you may pick up?
Yeah, so I mean, there are a couple of different things to think about here. One is that the AirPlay data are all data based on AirPlay decisions made between 2004 and 2008. Okay, and so in some ways those are more vulnerable to this concern, and in some ways the critic data is even more vulnerable to this concern because, especially when you think about the Rolling Stone editors, they are certainly they would seem to be nostalgic for 1970. The sales data here, however, are actually data from the entire period 1970 up to 2010 or so, 2008. And so here I'm identifying patterns not just from recent decisions, but from decisions made all the way through this time period. So although there could be some influence of that, I don't think that, given that I get this from all these different approaches that don't necessarily rely on the nostalgia of, you know, of people at a point in time, I don't think that's what's going on. I also, since I did all this, I actually have gotten the data I always had wished I had, the Nielsen data, for a number of, 22 countries, and the patterns emerge all over the place, even places with different demographic baby boom patterns. So that's a good question. I get it. I've gotten it a lot. So here, this is entirely independent now. This is the sales data, entirely independent of the AirPlay data. I mean, in the sense that they're not literally, you know, connected in any way, and entirely independent of the critic data. And so when I do this process on these data, here's what I get. I get an increase since 1999, right? So again, these data that are derived from actual economic decisions show an increase in the usefulness, if you will, of music in this period when revenue has been collapsing. Okay, so what's the bottom line from this first set of studies? There's no evidence that vintage quality has declined in the digital era. There's more compelling evidence that it's increased, because I would argue that the stuff based on behavior as opposed to the view of elites is more compelling. You know, you could make it would be reasonable to register the concern that, you know, I'm showing the impact or what has happened in a period when we had this compound change, both bad news on the demand side and good news on the supply side. And so I'm certainly not isolating separately the impact of Napster versus cost reduction. This is just on net what seems to have happened in this industry. So if one wanted separate answers to the question, what would happen if we just had a cost reduction? Or what would happen if we just had revenue reduction? I can't do that here. And I do believe, based on work I've done in other contexts, that if one just had a revenue reduction and not a cost reduction, one wouldn't expect good news. Okay, so like in India in the 80s, when piracy was rampant in movies, actually pretty strong evidence of a reduction in the production of movies. Big reduction in the production of movies. All right, so I'm not saying that the mix of good news and bad news would everywhere and always be good news for production. Anyways, this is a big contrast to the view that's implied by what happened to revenue and implied by what the industry talks about when they talk about the catastrophe in revenue. But if you believe me so far, you might be puzzled. I was a bit puzzled. Well, why would this be happening? You know, why would there be a big increase in quality given a collapse of revenue? So let me try to talk about that. So here we get to this nobody knows idea. I think a fundamental feature of creative products, not just music, but movies, books, probably others, is this nobody knows anything idea that I mentioned before. Here I'll credit it to both Richard Caves, but it's really originally Goldman. He wrote Princess Bride. He wrote the screenplay to the Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. So he's not an economist, but he's a guy we should listen to. Anyways, his notion is it's hard to predict what's going to be successful at the time of investment. And the statistics that people who study this tend to trot out are numbers like 5 to 10% of products that get released end up covering their costs. So that supports the notion it's hard to predict. Now, if you think about how digitization would change things, it's useful to think for a minute about the world before digitization. So traditionally, it's been expensive to, quote, experiment. So here I'm borrowing Marco Tervio's term, experiment, but just meaning in order to figure out which products are going to be successful with consumers, you need to bring them to market and then see who likes them. In the music context, it has traditionally cost about $1 million to bring a new album to market, a new album by a new artist. Now, that might sound like a ridiculous or astounding number, but even in like last year or the last 2 years, the IFPI's Investing in Music report describes, you know, in some detail what it costs to bring a new product to market according to the model that they, by which they do it, and that's the number that they cite. It costs $1 million. So in a world like that, the strategy is to, you know, do your best to choose which artists are worth investing in and then bet on those. And then, of course, most of them fail, even just because it's a hard problem, not because the traditional investors are bad at it. Okay, so you bet on a few artists with ex ante promise. Many fail, a few succeed, and then life goes on. Well, then bring digitization into the picture. So we've already talked about some aspects of this. On the demand side, you've got some bad news. But on the supply side, as I've said a few times now, the possibility of reductions in cost. Now, I'm going to show you shortly a lot of data about how there's been an increase in the number of products that come to market. So that means that the cost reductions have to be important if they're offsetting the revenue reductions. Okay? So if we take the view that the data showing an increase in the number of products available aren't wrong, and I don't think they are, then the one way to think about it, keeping in mind this is an unpredictable process, is that effectively it's become cheaper to experiment. That is to bring a product to market and see whether people turn out to like it. So we're taking more draws, well, we, society, we're taking more draws from the urn, meaning sticking some more, in this case, musical artists out there to see if their work is appealing to people. And the question is, if we can take more draws from the urn, do we end up discovering more artists who end up in the right tail as very successful and therefore important to consumers and valuable to consumers and sellers? All right, so how would this work? Maybe, I think in some sense, what I've said in words is all I need to say, but a tiny bit of formalism might be helpful, probably not. But if you could think about, you know, think about a little bit of a model here where there's some true quality of a musical artist's recorded music product, but the investor, the label, just forms a guess. So the truth is Q, the guess is Q prime, which is the truth plus a random error. Okay? Now, as I said, cost reductions obviously important even given piracy, because we do see an increase. So let's just say that effectively what happens is that the cost threshold T falls. And so now more things can be brought to market. And what would happen to the volume of, quote, good work? Well, so just suppose for a second, just for illustration's sake, let's pretend there is no unpredictability. All right, so this is the world without any unpredictability. What I have is a picture here with a threshold of this marketability threshold. You could think about it as the expected revenue from releasing a product. And there's the old threshold T. It used to be we release stuff that's better than that. Then the threshold falls. We release some new stuff. Now, let's just think for a second. If this were the world, adding products would be beneficial to consumers because you'd get some new products that are here. They're not very good, but it would add something. This wouldn't get us very far resolving the puzzle of a big increase in the quality experienced. So this story without unpredictability isn't going to get us very far. But when we add unpredictability in there, Now we're going to release all the products where our guess of how good it is above the new cost threshold. Well, indeed, a lot of them will be terrible, but some of them will be very good and end up in the right tail of the distribution. And that's what could account or explain an increase in this experienced quality. Okay? So that's the idea. The release of products with less ex ante promise leads to a greater number of products with ex post success and value. Whoops. I just pressed the wrong button. There we go. All right, so again, that's all just kind of blue sky thinking. If it's true, it should have some implications in data. And so here are some empirical questions that I try to address with the in some cases, unorthodox data that I've been collecting, in some cases, not so unorthodox. Are there more? Let me just articulate the questions on this slide, then talk for the next few slides about some data that are suggestive or indicative of answers. Are there more new products? I've already hinted about this. But including more low ex ante quality products, for example, in the case of music, indie records, that is records from independent record labels, the ones that maybe wouldn't have seemed to have great promise at the time that they initially hit the market. Second, do consumers have ways of learning about the proliferation of new products? As I said, there is a proliferation. And here I'll show you some changing roles of traditional radio, internet, and other sources of information. And then in some ways, the most important direct test here is the following. Do products with less ex ante promise? And again, I want to be clear about that since I'll come back to the notion. You know, so imagine there are a whole bunch of would-be artists who say, here, invest in me, invest in me. And the gatekeepers can order them from the most predictably successful to those who are less predictably successful, understanding that we're not very good at predicting. And the ones that are less predictably successful, those are the less ex ante promise, those are the ones that don't make it in the traditional world onto major record labels. If they get released at all, it's on kind of in this independent fringe sector. It's enormous, but it's a fringe kind of economically, at least traditionally. But do they end up accounting for a growing and potentially high fraction of the realized ex post successful artists? That's going to be the test that I apply in these various industries. Okay. An anecdote is nice. So let me talk about the Arcade Fire album, The Suburbs. So this is Arcade Fire is a Canadian band. They're pretty popular with hipsters, but they're not very popular in a mainstream sense. They don't get played on the radio in the U.S. hardly at all. So they released their third album, The Suburbs, is it August 3rd, 2011? It was critically acclaimed. So the Metascore, so if you go to Metacritic, which is an aggregator of review information, the Metascore was 87. That's like an A, a pretty good grade. They had very little conventional airplay. If you look at the Billboard airplay chart, they never appeared on the Billboard, on the high airplay chart, the one they release in Billboard magazine. On the other hand, they were pretty big on internet radio. Now here I had to be creative. I was able to get data on Last.fm, the top 420 songs per week at Last.fm. By the way, for a couple of years, I embarrassed myself by not understanding why the Last.fm ranking had 420 songs on it. Anyways, enough said about that. But what happened to this album? Well, first of all, so again, it's an ex-ante, it's a low ex-ante promise album. Even though they appeal to hipsters and, you know, the editors of Pitchfork, it's not a predictably commercially successful kind of an album. But it turns out to be a winner on the sales side. It's gold in the U.S. By now, maybe it's platinum. It also won the Best Album Grammy in 2011. Not the Best Alternative Album. No, it won actually the Best Album Grammy. So it's kind of an interesting story. Oh, by the way, that's just a picture of the spins or streams of this at Last.fm around the time that it came out. Okay. Let me get back, though, to more systematic answers to these questions about that I articulated. So is there a growth in releases? Yes. So I don't have the full Nielsen data, but if you even look at Billboard magazine's accounts of the Nielsen data, you see discussions of how the number of new products appearing in the data rises from about 35,000 in the U.S. in 2000 to about 100,000 in about 2010. So more or less a tripling in the number of new products, not the number of total, the number of new products. And since then, I've seen this in other data sources. You can see this in the Music Brains data and the Discogs data. There's clearly been an increase in the number of products released. Okay. That's all I'll say about that. I have more information, but for today, that's all I'll say. How about the changing information environment? So this is kind of important, because suppose you have a tripling in the number of new products. how do consumers learn about them? You know, if there are all these new products but nobody can know about them, it seems pretty hard for them to have any effect on consumption. So what can I say here? I mean, I should say at the outset, I wish that I had, you know, super detailed AirPlay data, and I wish I had the data on all the streams on Pandora and Spotify and Deezer. Nobody has that except those private companies, but I was able to find a few things. So Billboard, as I mentioned, releases an AirPlay chart, the top 75 songs per week. They call it the Hot 100 or something, but it's only got 75 on it. I don't quite understand why. And then there are, so if you look at that, you get like 3,900 listings per year, which is, I think, the product of 52 and 75, but only about 300 distinct artists, because artists remain on there for multiple weeks, right? Then if you compare that Billboard list with the Last FM list from the same time period, what's interesting is not that different total number of artists that show up there, but very little overlap. And I'm saying that as evidence that the new sources of information, other than traditional terrestrial radio, are certainly providing avenues for artists who wouldn't be promoted in the traditional way to be discovered by consumers. Right? So there's more one would like to be able to say, but certainly with what I could get my hands on, one can get that impression. Here, you know, if you're a music person, you might find this chart kind of amusing. We have on one side the top Billboard AirPlay artists that are not on Last FM, and these are sort of very popular, well-known commercial artists. On the right-hand side, we have the top artists in Last FM in the same time period, but who weren't in Billboard, and they're rather different. A lot of it is sort of indie hipster stuff. Some of it's not. The Beatles obviously don't correspond to that. The left-hand side one is, so at the time I made this chart, it was reminding me of, there's a satellite radio station in the US called 20 on 20. Just the top 20 songs repeated every three hours or something. I called it the soundtrack of hell. My children enjoyed listening to it. I didn't. Anyways, it's just a rather different, just to give you a feel for what's being promoted through the different channels. It's rather different. All right, second, and still under the topic of ways to learn about the new products, there's also been, and this is also a digital phenomenon, a big growth in both criticism and the dissemination of criticism. So this picture is a little hard to explain. What is it? So if you go to Metacritic and look at the underlying sources of critical information at Metacritic, so it's things like Rolling Stone, Pitchfork, and a whole host of sources of critical information, and then you ask, what year was that outlet founded? So then you sort of add up the number of reviews according to when the outlet that Metacritic is drawing on was founded on. So you see there's a big chunk of reviews attributable to Rolling Stone, which was founded in 1967 or something. But then you see that a lot of foundings occur in this period. And many of these are pure play digital products, like Pitchfork, probably the most famous, which, by the way, was purchased by Condé Nast yesterday or the day before. So the avant-garde becomes commercial. I don't know. There's Pitchfork. So the point is, all these are, I think all of them, certainly Pitchfork and many of them, are free to access online. You don't have to go buy a magazine. So there's lots of information out there that consumers can see and learn about these new products. Right? So again, the big question is, are there ways to learn about these new products? There at least are some new ways to learn about them. Okay, what's happening to the role of critics? I think that question should have come before. But let's talk about learning from critics versus radio. So now what I want to do with these pictures is think about the albums or the artists who become commercially successful. And the left-hand side shows the share of the commercially successful albums in the Billboard 200 over this period of time, 91 to 2010, that are heavily played on the radio. See how it's falling? Whereas on the right, we see the share that are being reviewed in Metacritic, which again is this aggregator of critical information, and we see a big increase. So this is certainly consistent with people being able to learn about these new products via new mechanisms or new avenues. Okay, so let's talk about ex ante promise and ex post success. In some ways, I said this was the most important direct test. So to the artists with less ex ante promise, like who would not have made it to market, at least not meaningfully, prior to digitization, now achieve sales success. And so here again, what I'm looking at, because at the time the only data I could get my hands on as sales data were the Billboard 200. So just to be clear about that, by week in the US, it's the top 200 selling albums. Okay, so I can get that back to 1985 in a manner that I could afford. And then you can aggregate those up to the year level, and you can link them to a separate Billboard chart, music on independent labels. And so what I'm asking here, do the indies account for a growing share of the commercially successful? And the answer is yes. If you look at the indie share among the Billboard 200, it rises from about 15 to about 35%, almost a tripling, period between 2001 and 2010. Even if you look at the top 25 by week and aggregate those across weeks. So the right-hand side picture shows that this phenomenon is occurring even at the top of the distribution, meaning that some of these ex-ante, just for shorthand's sake, call them ex-ante losers, are ex-ante winners in a big sense. They're at the top of the distribution. That rises from about 6 to about, 18%. Right? So that, to me, this is an interesting picture because it says a lot of things that are starting out without a lot of promise in the new digitized world are ending up pretty successful. Okay. Yes, if you are a Tom Petty fan, then you'll like this quote. Even the losers get lucky sometimes. So summing up the music evidence, I'd say a few things. Digital disintermediation, if you wanted to use that word for this whole phenomenon, although we could fight about that word, it provides a possible explanation for this increase in quality, given the unpredictability, more experimentation, meaning bringing more things to market to see if people like them, leads to the discovery of additional good or successful music. Ex-ante losers become ex-post winners. And a lot of this stuff wouldn't have happened without digitization, is my argument. Okay, but what about other cultural products? How are we doing on time?
Fine.
Okay, fine.
At least another 15 minutes.
Okay, that's perfect. So how about other cultural products? Books, motion pictures, television, photography. So of each, I think the questions I'd like to ask. I'd like to ask, are there more products? Are there ways to learn about the new products? Let's forget about sales concentration just for time. Is there a growing success of the ex-ante losers? Are the new vintages good? All right, these are the questions. Now, I should say that in these other media or these other categories, there isn't really a Napster event. It's not to say there isn't piracy. There is piracy, but there isn't like a time when piracy began and became rampant. So instead, we might go into these industries thinking that we have mostly a cost shock and not mostly a revenue shock. Again, there is piracy, plenty of it, but I don't think there's like a huge change in piracy. So you might even think of these contexts as contexts where we're seeing impacts of cost reductions distinct from a revenue reduction. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about books. So is there growth in new products? So it's actually a little bit hard to get measures of the number of new products. There are a few sources like Bowker, Books in Print, there's an almanac. And if you get slightly different numbers from the different sources, but they all show you pictures that look kind of like this. This is just one particular, this is self-published. This one has increased enormously. But all the indices that I can come up with that are measures of the number of new titles brought to market show pretty substantial increases, at least in the U.S. I haven't had indices for other countries. And, at the same time, there's a pretty big growth. If you think about e-books as an important phenomenon, and I think they are, there's also a pretty big growth in the kind of ecosystem for consuming e-books. In the U.S., it's largely Kindle, but also a few other reading products. So there is this growth in the ability to consume as well as the number of new products that come into existence. So yes, especially the self-published e-books supported by this diffusion of tablets and readers. Let me jump to what I think is the most interesting test in the context of books. So again, the big question is, do the new products that kind of wouldn't have made it past gatekeepers before end up being a big share of what ends up being commercially successful? So what these pictures are pictures of the share of top bestsellers, that is the share of the top 150 by week in the U.S. that are titles which were originally self-published. Okay, so in the case of a book like 50 Shades of Grey, it eventually is published by a conventional traditional publisher, but it was originally self-published, so it would stay in these data as a self-published or as an originally self-published book. And so it's really kind of, I found this kind of astonishing. This is a work with a former grad student professor at Northeastern now. We look at the share of these overall bestsellers, and we find, it's kind of around zero until about 2011, then it just starts to rise, and it peaks above 15%. It's fluctuated a bit since then. 15% of titles are books that were originally self-published. If you look at the romance category, which is the category where 50 Shades lives, it's 40%. I mean, that's kind of astonishing. These are people who, you know, what does it take? These are largely people who write a book, render it as PDF, upload it to the Kindle direct platform, and charge $5 for it. Now, most of these don't sell anything, but a bunch of them sell a lot. And it's kind of an interesting shift in that industry. Now, again, if I'm going to use the word quality in the context of the word 50 Shades, then, again, remember what I mean by quality is just stuff that people buy. There's 50 Shades. Okay. By the way, 50 Shades is four separate entries on the list because it's a trilogy and a box set. So there are four different ways for 50 Shades to get in there. All right, so that's a quick jaunt into books. Let's talk a little bit about motion pictures. Movies are different. My thought going into movies, they're different in a couple of ways. For one thing, when you think about the movies that are economically most important, especially from the U.S., the movies from the Motion Picture Association of America are really big deal investments. They used to report a number every year, the average cost of making one. Last time they reported it, 2003, it was $100 million per movie. So that's a lot. That's a lot of money. And so you really would think that, you might think things are somehow different here. Moreover, movies are kind of an important export industry for the U.S., and people do talk about jobs even in this industry. So I guess this slide is just meant to suggest there's even maybe more at stake in this industry. All right. Well, let's talk about setting the stage here. So again, I don't think there's a big shock to revenue. Of course, there are things that happen, like DVD becomes a big deal, then less of a big deal. But there isn't, and there's lots of piracy in much of the world, but there isn't a Napster-like watershed event after which revenue plummets. So I think most of the interesting story here is a story about what's happening on the cost side. And here, as in the others, you could talk about production and distribution and promotion. And so I'll talk a little bit about those things. On the production side, we've seen a real growth in digital cameras, especially since 2005. It used to be that the camera to make a movie you could release theatrically or for distribution was a very expensive Panavision or something, $250,000. You rented it and shot on film. Very expensive. Even, just to make a movie of that sort, very expensive. Starting in 2005, you could buy a camera for about $2,000 that could produce essentially cinema quality. People from the industry might fight with me about that, but there are certainly many examples of movies distributed that are shot on, the Canon, whatever it is, 5D Mark III, $2,000 body. Distribution. Well, it used to be you needed to get into a lot of theaters, make prints, get distribution deals. That's all very expensive. But starting more recently, a lot of movies are largely sold digitally. So there are platforms like iTunes, Netflix, Amazon. There are actually quite a few more platforms, but there are lots of platforms that involve less costly distribution. Amazon is essentially a passive player. You take your movie and upload it there. If it's not porn, you can distribute it. They take 30%, you take 70%. So again, it's not like having to buy your way into a theater. Now, promotion is really a challenge, right? So promotion is a big deal in getting people interested in movies. And so I'll show you some evidence in a few moments about this. Lots of movies that are being reviewed. There's a pretty rich information environment in this context, both professional reviews, user-generated reviews. So all of this, again, this is all just suggestive until I show you data, but all of this raises the possibility of, first, a bunch of new products, and second, products that might actually be discovered by and useful to consumers. So is that going to turn out to be true? All right, so on the production side, and I kind of mentioned this already, but digital cameras have been around for a little while, and they've been widely adopted in some ways since about 2005, but certainly since more recently than that. And if you think about the price of the hardware needed to make a movie, and I realize hardware is a small component of the $100 million cost of the big deal movies, but the price of sort of entry into being able to make a movie, period, has just fallen enormously. And it creates big opportunities especially for independent filmmakers, right? It doesn't really change things if you're thinking about spending $100 million, but if you're thinking about making a movie with three of your friends, as some relatively famous artists now do, it changes things quite a lot. All right, this is IMDb, the Internet Movie Database, is quite a neat database, has all kinds of information. One of the things they have, not for every movie, but for some movies, is the kind of camera used to make the movie, okay? And It's pretty neat, right? It's pretty neat. Now, it's missing a lot, so I don't know how representative this is, but certainly this is just, I've claimed that there's been an increase in digital, the use of digital equipment to make movies, and the digital ones are the ones that are growing a lot towards the end of this bar chart, so just wherever you see things changing, that's digital. Okay, all right. Okay, now having said all that, let's think about the number of products. It's in sort of a non-trivial question, what is the number of products? If you think about the number of products released by the Motion Picture Association members, so these are the wide-release movies produced by one of the member studios, the answer is that it hasn't increased. It's kind of, even going back to 30 years, it kind of fluctuates, 150, 200. Lately, it's been around 150. So it hasn't gone up. That has not gone up, okay? But a very different notion of the number of products is the number of movies that have an IMDb page. Okay, and so IMDb, again, wonderful database. In this case, it's owned by Amazon, by the way. You can query the database and say, show me how many movies with a US origin were produced in 1990 or 2003. You know, just, and you can ask it those questions. And so what these pictures are, we have US origin features, US origin documentaries. Now, I have to concede it's possible, since IMDb is largely user-generated, and IMDb has only existed since the early 90s, it's certainly possible that their coverage of old movies is missing and there's some bias upward, but they've existed since 1995, and the period I really want to focus on is more recent, and what you see is a very substantial increase in the number of movies that have an IMDb page, especially since about 2005. So we're up at around 3,000 in the U.S., for features, another 4,000 for documentaries, and this is, I believe this is, right, this is the whole world. So the point is, it's not just the U.S. The U.S. isn't doing all the work in these pictures. It's not just a U.S. phenomenon. But, you know, having said this, you know, if you've spent some time at IMDb, you know that a lot of those 3,000 movies aren't really economically important products. All right, so I don't want to leave it at this. Let's talk about some more stuff. So let's think about now the gulf between the large-scale, wide-release movies and others. So what this picture shows, the bottom two lines, one is the MPAA number again, and then the dotted line is the number of movies released in the U.S. on 500 or more screens. So that's kind of a threshold for wide release. And again, the number of wide-release movies isn't rising. But the number of movies that show up in theaters in the U.S. up here is rising. So there's a lot of narrow release movies, okay? They might be released for a very brief period of time in not very many theaters. You know, you read the industry press, you know, a lot of this is about getting a review and then distributing it via iTunes, HBO, or whatever, okay? But certainly this is another notion of what's a product. These are surely products people mean to try to sell because they're putting them out there and trying to sell them. What's another way to think about this? If you think about the movies, this is actually a bad picture for what I want to try to say, but let me focus on the year 2010. So in the year 2013, I asked the following question. How many movies that had been released originally in 2010 had been commercially marketed and via what sort of channels? And so again, the number in theaters is about that 550 number. We already saw that number. But then if you ask, well, how many 2010 vintage movies were there at Netflix in 2013? And the answer was, I don't know, what is that, about 1,000? And as of 2013, how many vintage 2010 movies were at Amazon? So Amazon Instant, not Prime. Prime is the subscription service. Instant is just the a la carte service. And as of that time, it was about, what, 1,200? I suspect it's more now. It's really growing. They have like 40,000, I don't know, a really large number of movies in the a la carte service at this point. Okay. So that's a lot of numbers. My point is there's been an increase in production, including and an increase in the number of movies that are, I think are purposefully marketed to consumers and available to consumers. All right. And not, you know, even if you doubt the 3,000 number at IMDb, there's certainly 1,200 is bigger than 150. Yeah. Okay. So now let's talk about, can consumers learn about these products? So this is generally the product discovery problem. So there's been significant growth in review provision and availability. And it's really, there's a range, I'd say, professionals plus amateurs providing information to others. So what do I do here? What I've done in this picture is to try to think about the top 1,000 movies by by time, and ask how probable is it that the movie is has a review? Okay, so I'm not saying this very well. So if you look at the top over here, what this is saying is this is like the top movies that have, and these movies have always been ubiquitously reviewed in traditional outlets. Okay, but if you go back, now let's jump down to here. These are movies that are way farther down the distribution. In 1990, it's essentially none of them are the 1990 movies, there's very little information about them. But as you come closer to the present, you can see that even movies very far down the distribution, and this is the distribution measured by the number of IMDb users who rate the movie, right? Because that is available for almost every product, whereas box office revenue by construction is only available for a small number of products. The point is, these rising bars are just telling you that the depth, the distance into the distribution that movies have information available about them, sorry for that bad sentence, is rising. Okay. What are some other ways to think about this? If you ask the number of movies which have an IMDb user rating. Now, to have an IMDb user rating, you need to have at least 5 people rate you. Otherwise, there's no rating. All right. So you can just see across vintage, as of 2013, the number of movies about which there is a rating is rising. All right. And maybe this is overkill, but take a particular movie, Argo, kind of a popular movie a few years ago. And let's just think about how many reviews were there for Argo. Well, there were 588 reviews. And again, this IMDb has this very cool, you know, you kind of click down and you could find all the different sources that gave a review. And so these range from very big outlets to sort of obscure blogs. The way I'm characterizing this is to take the Alexa traffic rank of the outlet. So the outlet might be the New York Times, or it might be Joe's film blog. I'm making that up. And Joe's film blog might be ranked 2,655. You take the natural log of that number, you can kind of put the histogram in the same picture. And I'm just saying there's an enormous range of outlets that are providing information about, in this case, a pretty prominent movie. So it just gives you a feel for what's out there. Okay. And I should also say, although these aren't all professionals, these are a notch above simply people who are giving a star rating at IMDb, because these are either actual public, you know, editorial outlets or blogs that have enough of a following that IMDb would link to them. Okay, so this is not just the same as total kind of wisdom of crowd stuff. All right, but let's get to the important question. Do the independent movies succeed? So again, the question I keep asking in these industries is, do the products that begin with low ex-ante promise become an important chunk of what's ex-post successful? Well, here there are a lot of challenges in deciding what is it that constitutes a low ex-ante promise product. You know, we could just say the word independent, but even that word has a lot of meanings. And so, you know, if you look through different sources in the movie industry, you know, you get this word means different things. So one definition, like the independent spirit guys, they have a definition that essentially says, well, you can be made by an independent or a major as long as you have independent vision. So that's kind of the I know it when I see it definition. Then IndieWire. So I discovered IndieWire, which is a very nice magazine or website that actually has a chart showing the box office revenue to indie movies. But then I realized their definition is released on not so many screens. So that's kind of like movies predicted to be unsuccessful. So that didn't seem like a great definition. So what I went with is movies not produced by one of the major studios as a definition of independent, understanding that this is a complex environment. All right, so what does one see? Well, indies are actually a growing share of both box office revenue as well as DVD revenue. Now, this is kind of surprising to me. I don't have a deep database of DVD revenue. I just have, like, I think it's the top 30 by week for a bunch of weeks. I would have thought that was dominated by non-indie stuff, but it really, the share indie is both kind of significant and growing, especially recently, even among in that distribution channel. If you look, I apologize for all the data, but I'm enthusiastic about it. This picture shows you the share of indie stuff among what's being distributed through various channels across vintages. So it's kind of hard to even say that. But if you look at Amazon Instant, let's say, the red one, and you ask, as of 2013, when I made this picture, and you ask, of the stuff at Amazon Instant that was originally released in 1980, what share of it's indie? And how does that compare to today? And you see a rising share of these movies that are available for sale that are indie. Now, in some sense, that has to be true, right? Because there's a growing number of indie movies as long as they're made available for sale, given that the major stuff is pretty flat. That has to be true, so that can't be surprising. Okay, are the new movies good? All right, so there are, again, two kinds of approaches to this based on critics and usage. So let me start with the one that's sort of easy to understand. Rotten Tomatoes is a pretty neat website. It's an aggregator of review information that turns critics' reviews of movies into two-digit numbers. And so what I did here is I just took all the movies back to 1993 that have a score of 87 or above. And you just see the absolute number of movies, 87 or above, is rising. Okay, so the number of absolutely good movies, according to the elites who make these decisions, is rising. Absolute number of movies going up. Now, moreover, so that by itself, that's kind of good news, but it's not clear that it's my mechanism. It's only my mechanism if these are being driven by the indies. And so if you ask the share of the Rotten Tomatoes movies that are getting great grades, how many of them are indie? Oh, it turns out it's a big and rising, sharply rising share. Okay. Now, again, you could say that Yuri Dreams of Sushi is not an economically important movie because we don't know its box office revenue, I don't think, but if we knew how many times people streamed it at Netflix, we could say a little more, but we don't. All right. One other point to make, though, I keep kind of dumping on elites, but in some data sets, you have both the views of the lay people and elites. So at Metacritic, you can get a user score and a critic score for every movie. And what this picture shows, I mean, at one level, it just shows a cloud. But if you're a statistician, it's a highly correlated cloud. And so the movies that elites like more, regular humans like more too. So that suggests some economic consequentiality, if that's a word, consequence of the elites liking things more. All right, now, okay, yeah, so this is a perfect time to not talk about this next slide because it's a little geeky and it's all good news. Turns out TV is undergoing a renaissance, if you'll forgive the expression. And yeah, and so is photography. That shouldn't be too surprising. I mean, photographers are pretty upset about how cheap their competition is. But the number of photographs at Getty by vintage has just absolutely exploded. Because it turns out that even I can take a good picture if I shoot 5,000 of them. All right, so this is a good way to kind of slow down. New digital technology has brought threats to creative industry, piracy for sure. I mean, and it's a realized threat in music. I would be the first to agree that piracy is largely, if not completely, responsible for the collapse of recorded music revenue. But it also has brought opportunities through other aspects of digitization. Not the piracy per se. That is not good news in and of itself. There's been huge growth in the number of new products in a lot of industries, as well as the number being distributed. And a lot of the new products, and when I say new, I mean a lot of products that wouldn't have made it past the sort of traditional intermediaries, make up a large and growing share of what turns out to be important and successful. So threats to revenue, they're real, and so I don't want to dismiss that. That stuff's important. But when we think about how I think one should assess whether copyright-protected industries are working, one should assess it according to whether there's a bunch of good new stuff being created that's useful to people. And here we see no sign of diminished output in these industries, and we see that a lot of the good, in many senses, the new works are good, if not better. So I think things look pretty healthy. Now, what should we say about public policy? And I don't want to overinterpret anything, but let's just talk about what things are potentially relevant. So, rights holders are concerned about revenue, and that's fully understandable. But I think, copyright exists to provide incentives for creative activity. And despite the revenue performance in music, actually, we didn't talk about newspapers, but if you look at revenue pictures for newspapers, they're just as awful as the revenue pictures, if not worse. Revenue pictures in music. So despite those really horrific looking pictures, and I think well-founded fears in other industries, there seems to be no crisis at all in creative activity. So that's where I'll stop.
Thank you, Joel, and I really hated to cut you short.
No, because, that's fine. Even I was tired of hearing me. It's good.
I think you've done an outstanding entrepreneurial effort to look for data that can say something intelligent about how creativity has evolved in these various content industries. I have one question, if you allow me, and then I'll open to the floor. And maybe based also on your conclusion, I think you've made a fairly convincing case that there is, or not fairly, you made a convincing case that there is no crisis in creative activity. Now, as an economist, one of the things that has recently received a lot of attention, is the evolution in the distribution of incomes, and creativity and sort of how much people earn from creativity doesn't necessarily correlate with one another. There has always been the case in the creative industries that, few people get very rich and most don't. But is there any evidence, and I know this really goes beyond the research that you've presented today, but is there any evidence on how the income of first of all, musicians, but also those more broadly involved in the creative industries has evolved?
Yeah, that's a good question. Not that I've done. So there are people who've done research on the evolution of revenue sources in music, for example. And I think they make a pretty convincing argument that revenue from live performance has become more important. Ticket prices have risen, but more importantly, revenue from live performance has risen. And that seems like a natural consequence of sort of losing control of the recorded music product. There are a few folks who've studied, like Peter DeCola at Northwestern has a study of income sources. He surveyed musicians and trying to see the relevance or the importance of copyright as a direct revenue source for them. So there is some work out there. I don't know much about it. I will tell you that there are a lot of artists, including artists I know and respect and find interesting, who are pretty unhappy, right? So there's a lot of grumbling out there, which stands, I think, in interesting contrast to what I see as a creative flowering. But nevertheless, there's a lot of grumbling. And look at like Spotify. So Spotify, in one sense, is providing revenue in contexts that where there wasn't revenue before. But a lot of artists look at it and say, this is terrible. This is not enough compensation. So there's a lot of grumbling about income, which is not really a very deep answer to your question, except to acknowledge that it's an important one.
Okay, please. And maybe if you could identify yourself when you pose a question. Benoit, yeah.
Thank you, Kosten. My name is Benoit Müller. I'm an attorney in Geneva. And I have several clients in the content industry, and that for many years, although I've also worked for the IT industry. Interesting presentation. Thank you. I have a lot of comments and questions, and certainly I would also echo the comment by the chief economist on. I can report some anecdotal data from film directors who's, for instance, from Ghana, whose film television series has been viewed more than 1 million times. On YouTube, and the revenue she got from that is less than $2,000. So, to your question as to whether copyright works for creativity, I would put some question marks. It works for very large distributors, yes, but does it work for those who actually create? I would also question your definition of what is a product. I think that's a bit, at least to me, it's a bit confusing as to whether you're referring to the underlying work or whether you're referring to a physical or immaterial copy of that work and its economic value. Certainly point out that copyright has an incentive to get more works out there in the world, but I think it doesn't quite fit with the very heavy focus on the supply side of your research, and I would compel WIPO. I've I think, attended all of your seminars, certainly in the field of copyright, to think about, you know, in the future, featuring research that looks more from the perspective of creators and not that from, you know, big companies we know are close here in Zurich or, you know, around the world, but the view from those who create, and not just in America. I work a lot with creators in Africa, and I think they have a different worldview. Thank you.
Should I respond? Or, yeah. So no, thank you for those. Thank you for those comments. I mean, there is a really interesting question. You know, what does it mean for copyright to be working? Because I certainly, again, I hear from a lot of artists who are grumbling and saying it's not working. But you know, there's this new thing called online education, which threatens my income as a professor. And yet people might get educated by it. And I might say it's terrible, but people might get educated. Is education working if people are getting educated but I have a lower income? Probably it is. And so with sadness, I might have to say that if a creator says, I'm upset, I'm unhappy, but nevertheless, we as consumers observe that he or she is creating a bunch of stuff, by their behavior, copyright is working. And so I don't know we can ask people how happy, I mean, certainly whether people are happy is important because they give voice politically to their, through, you know, to their happiness or unhappiness. But I feel as though the evidence about production and stuff made available, and when possible, I agree with you, consumption is very important when one can get the data. If we see stuff produced and consumed, then that would be a pretty good way to think that things are working.
Yes, please.
Thank you.
Thank you. Whichever. Why don't you go ahead? Ladies first.
Microphone works. Thank you. My name is Gabriele Lebert. I wanted to say that, of course, it's very interesting to see who, after all the statistics that we have seen in the presentation, and the word revenue came up quite a number of times, as the gentleman next to me said, who is really earning revenue in the context? Is it the creator, the musician, the filmmaker, or is it the producer and the industry? And my point about the copyright in the existing form, in our traditional way we use copyright, has to obviously change in this new digitalized era. And I'm sure that from our point of view at WIPO, there needs to be a lot of adjustment made to find ways to protect the artists in a new revolutionary way, not in the old existing traditional copyright law.
So may I say something about that? I agree that there's a lot of interesting questions about kind of creators versus intermediaries. And let me answer the question not with an answer so much as a puzzle. So traditional author contract, what is it, 15% of cover price, you know, 7.5% of wholesale price. And then the presumption is that the publisher will do some promotion and maybe I'll get some money. If one were to publish a book through Amazon directly, the structure of the contract, you set whatever price you want, you set a price above $5, you, the creator, keep 70%. Hmm. Now, some, and it's pretty similar, you know, the iTunes contract's pretty similar, other contracts are similar.
Exactly.
Now, the question is this good news or bad news for creators if they can, it's essentially disintermediated, I mean, there is an intermediary, but it's a passive intermediary. Is this good news for creators or bad news for creators? In some sense, it's great news, but then one wonders how consumers learn about the product. And to think about was it the Ghanaian movie at YouTube, that maybe Amazon would have been a better place for that movie. I don't know. I don't know. But yeah. So I'm sympathetic to the concerns, and I think those are good questions. And one of the big problems is a lot of the intermediaries don't share any data. You know, we don't know how many times things get consumed. We don't, you know, we know contractual revenue shares, but we don't know how many times things are being purchased or downloaded. So we don't really know how different entities are doing in the whole kind of ecosystem. So I share the concerns, but I don't know. It's hard to say much without more data.
Thank you. Thomas Dillon, WIPO. And I confess that I used to work for the Motion Picture Association.
So. That's okay. I love motion pictures.
Thank you very much. It seems to me that we care a lot about the consumption of works, not so much about the production of works. And I have a feeling that many academics are misled by the copyright clause of the American Constitution into thinking that the incentive, it's a sufficient explanation or even a satisfactory explanation of a copyright, that it's an incentive for production. I think that the self-publishing on Amazon indicates very clearly that the real point of copyright is to permit distribution, not production. Poets will write poems, and 99% of them will never be published. And to that extent, art is advanced. But most economists, well, certainly all politicians, are interested in the size of the economy, not its quality. So I think that when you talk about production, what I'm missing is some control for price and assessment of relative revenue, I mean, against what they used to be, because you don't control for the shrinkage in the market, nor in your graphs, nor was there any place to. That wasn't what you were trying to say. But in fact, if we control for revenue, the actual size of the whole graph will be much smaller now, even though the relative pictures have changed. So the second thing is, I think that the danger with your conclusions is that it encourages the idea that there's a quid pro quo that should be accepted by the copyright industries. They should say, well, you know, we'd have been twice as wealthy now if there were adequate enforcement provisions, but hey, it costs less to make the stuff, so we're doing as well as we were 20 years ago. We should be happy. That is not how any normal industry operates. You've got to compare against what it would have been or what it would be in a series of different states of nature, it seems to me. And finally, a more sort of technical point, which probably betrays my lack of understanding. In relation to your measurements of quality, you're trying to tell us whether something is in an objective sense, good or not, sufficiently objective as to make policy decisions about it. But isn't the problem that if you take critics, critics can only tell you their assessment of a 2015 critic tells you his view of a 1970 work or modern work. But in order to have an objective measure of quality, you would have to know what the 1970 critic thought, not only the 1970 work, but also the 2015 work. And I don't think that data will ever be available.
So these are great points. I'd love to speak to these points. So thank you. You're right. So two points about the size of the economy. So what we care about is, just technically speaking, is the sum of consumer surplus and producer surplus. That's what we care about. It is true. And by that I mean, you know, how much would people be willing to pay for stuff that they get, less what they pay for it. That's the consumer side. And on the producer side, it's the revenue they get, less what it costs to make stuff. So you could colloquially just think of it as profit. It's clear in music that revenue is way down. Okay, so the sellers are, I mean, revenue's way down, costs are down, but I would say that revenue's down more than costs. So I take the point about pain on the seller side. But the point, I mean, we need to remember to care about the consumers and the producers, and so it's not as simple as just saying that I neglected that revenue fell, right? Because consumer surplus ballooned. So I think that's important. A second related point is that on this quality issue, really what I wish I could be measuring with quality is not critical quality, even though I end up relying on critics more than in some sense I wish I did. What I want to be measuring is whatever it is that animates people to wish to consume things. And so when I have the right kind of data, you know, the consumption data by time and vintage, I can use those data to see which vintages are more demanded given how old they are. And I think that does get around the real and, you know, genuine problem that you raise. So I think it's a data problem that separates me from satisfying the concern that you raise. But I think I have the data in music. And one of the slides I sped through with movies, I'll just take a second to talk about, was, so in movies, the way we consume, well, the traditional way we observe movie consumption is at the box office, so we never really observe much consumption of old movies. So we don't get vintage stuff. However, if you think about the new world of streaming and digital, you know, distribution, there's tons of data out there about consumption of old movies. I don't have any of those data. I do, however, have television listing data. So I have like the all the listing, or not all, but I was able to get hundreds of thousands of television listings on premium channels. And so with those data, you can see which vintages movies are being used. And it shows some promise in addressing. And so I want to more show sympathy with your stated concern than assert something about the result. Just to say, yes, with the right data, one could study this. If your friends in the motion picture industry would be willing to share with me the streaming data by time and vintage, we could do something together. Because I fully agree that it's consumption, you know, it's the two surpluses, the consumer surplus and the producer surplus, that are important, not the views of elites. Those are really relevant only in as much as they can be shown to be correlated with the stuff that really makes the gears go. So that's enough. Thank you, though. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Mariam Zehtabci. I'm a researcher in the Economics and Statistics Division here in WIPO. Correct me if I missed it, but I have like two questions here that you touched upon: quality and source of information. Okay, so when it comes to quality, you mentioned that, well, new works are generally good. How do you account for accessibility of big data? And what I have in mind, I'm looking at like a generation of original series when it comes to like House of Cards and Netflix, and the behavior of the consumers and all those statistics that they had access to when it was not available maybe 10 years ago, 15 years ago. The second question is about source of information. When you talked about the source of information in music, in film, was mainly through reviewers and the distribution channels. How do you account for the emergence of social media and the word of mouth in the modern way sense of
thank you. Let me just talk a little bit. So the big data, it is said that Netflix developed House of Cards, you know, making use of a lot of data analysis that helped make it predictably successful, or they knew that they should cast Kevin Spacey and so forth. And that may be true. And it's related to a phenomenon, and I've heard venture capitalists tell me about projects they're funding that supposedly can predict which music will be successful. Now, to the extent that there are such technologies or methods for lessening the unpredictability problem, that would be great news. I mean, and maybe, so it may well be, I don't actually doubt that Netflix was able to make use of data to predict. I mean, imagine if you could not have to produce the 90% of things that nobody wants. That would be really useful to society. So I'm interested in that. I can't account for it, but I just think it's a very interesting research question. The other thing on social sources of information and social media, I entirely agree that it's quite likely and certainly possible that social media provide a way of propagating information about new products. I haven't studied them, but I think it's very much worthy of study. Yeah.
Julio, and I'm afraid this is the last question because we are running out of time and we have another meeting. So what you're happy to just go for it.
It's kind of two questions, but
no sound of the tin.
Yes. So being quick, thank you very much for your presentation. You did a fantastic work of data, so I feel bad that I'm asking for more. But one thing I missed was the discussion about concentration, right? Or discussion about how many suppliers do we have in different moments of stages. Implicitly, we know, because of your data, that it seems that there are more producers upstream, right? There are more poets, as they were mentioned there, right? We at least this indie, I'm ready to believe that part, but I don't know how many intermediaries are now, and I don't know how many distribution channels are now. And some of the information that we get, I don't know how, you know, this might be me being ignorant, but the fact that you have iTunes, Amazon, it seems that has shrinked a lot compared to how many shops you had before to buy DVDs or books and all that. Maybe it's, you know, 2.0 fuzz, and we get the impression of this is not real, but maybe you know some literature. I would like to know more about this. I think this is an important thing. The other and very good question is, I found really interesting that you one for music, books, and movies, so very different pieces and different, very different moments of times. And I appreciate how you said that you had masters in music and you don't have an equivalent for the others. And I was thinking if there is anything of that sort that provides an interesting maybe experiment, because at least from my perception, not being an expert in the field, it's like you had Napster and similar things paving the road for iTunes, right? Well, and maybe for movies it was the same. I don't know, Megaupload or these kind of things. Maybe they paved the road for the Netflix. There was a demand that wanted to be digital there way before the more formal channels, or let's say the legit channels, were there. However, for books, it's not the same, right? We had Amazon selling books, physical books, and then Amazon went for the e-books and their own tablet system. So I was wondering if there's something special about this.
Yeah, no, a lot of interesting stuff there. The concentration of intermediaries is a really interesting question. I've been looking at it. I haven't really done a lot of systematic on it. Think about books. You know, Amazon's really dominant in books in the U.S., and so interestingly, they remain a pretty passive intermediary in the sense that you just upload your book, you get 70%. But there are questions about how you get it promoted. You know, you sort of have to agree to be in the Kindle Direct program in order to get some promotion. So there is an interesting question about downstream power. In video, in the U.S., we have right now, it looks like about 15 different platforms, although a few of them seem much more dominant than others. I mean, Netflix is by far dominant in the subscription space. But in the a la carte space, there are a bunch. The point I wanted to agree with you, though, is that I think it's a very interesting issue to monitor, because that's, even if you had democratization of production, if you don't have democratization of distribution, then issues could emerge. So I just want to agree that there's an issue there. The one thing, you know, you raise an interesting question about Napster prompting the development of iTunes. I mean, you know, music was the canary in the coal mine, you know, that went through this first and suffered and looks stupid in retrospect, but I'm pretty sure they're not stupid. I'm pretty sure it was just a hard problem. It's interesting that television, you know, when YouTube appears February 2005, within 6 months, the major TV networks in the US are putting some of their programming online. By the next fall season, everything is online. So I think there's, you know, if you think about sort of prompting events and learning, it's interesting to do case studies comparing these industries learning from each other, because they're not, music had it harder. It was first.
Okay, thank you very much. Apologies for not being able to accommodate all questions, but fortunately we don't have any more time. So let me finally thank Professor Waldfogel for an extremely interesting, provocative presentation. I think we all learned a lot, and we look forward to keeping in touch and learning about your ongoing research.
Thank you. Please email me if you didn't get to ask a question, or if you did and I answered it badly. Let's have a dialogue. Thank you.
Thank you.